And we're in a series this last really month or two. We've been talking about relaying again some foundations. It's time to build again as we go through a new season. And I'm trying to share with you new insights on the most important foundations so that we can build strong for the future. So far, we looked at the foundation of house churches as the primary building block of the New Testament church. This is called the corporate gathering or the congregational gathering, but in the early church, it was the house churches where the ministry was done, where people were one to the Lord, where people were healed, encouraged, things like that. And then the house churches on a regular basis got together into the congregational gathering for teaching, but also to receive God's power. As we sang, mercy is falling, Lord, help me to receive your mercy. Help me to receive your power. The congregational gathering is to receive God's impartation, his power, his empowerment, things like that, for direction in life, for demonstration and impartation. We looked at the foundation of salvation and saw that salvation is really a matter of renouncing our self-focused mentality. It's not just saying a prayer and say, gee, I feel sorry for my sins. Everybody feels sorry for their sins when we already mess up. But true salvation is about repenting or renouncing our self-focused mentality, receiving Jesus as King of Kings and Lord of Lords in our lives, and also receiving the Holy Spirit as our guide, as our empowerer, as our comforter, as our strength, and so much more. A couple weeks ago, we looked at the foundation of Jesus, and we saw that Jesus really is God's only solution for sins, not because he was trying to be exclusive, but because there was really only one person in all of existence who could satisfy the requirements for dying for our sins. He had to be perfectly God, and he had to be so that his sacrifice would be once for all, but he also had to be perfectly man, so that he could die for our sins, because it takes blood to be sacrificed for blood. And since there was only one person in all of creation that was fully God and fully man, that's who God sent to be sacrificed for our sins. We looked at the foundation of forgiveness and saw that in order to completely forgive, we not only have to deal with the offender, we have to deal with our expectations. We have to deal with our conclusions we've made concerning three people, right? Conclusions we made about the offender, conclusions we made about ourselves, and conclusions we made about God. And then we have to deal with our wounded emotions. And if we don't do that, we will not be able to fully forgive. I'm not sure if this is on here now. No, there is a six there. What I want to talk about today is the Father's love, the love of God. And what I want to do today is help you discover not just the warm feeling of his love, but to realize the transformational power that's available through his love. So we're going to lay that foundation today. What is the purpose of the Father's love? Why did God pour out his love into our lives? The Bible says that when we became Christians, God poured out his love by the Spirit into our lives. Why did he do that? Well, first we need to understand that God's love is intense love, wholehearted love. 1 John 4:16. So we know and rely on the love that God has for us. God is love. And whoever lives in love lives in God and God in him. God is love. The essence of God's being definitely is love. And so if God is in us, love is in us. If God is in us, love is in us. And if we live in God, we will live in love. To the extent that we live in God determines the extent that we live in love. But once you receive God by his Spirit, love is in you. Eternal love, pure love, wholehearted love. God's love is not just a warm feeling, it's intense love. And so everything God thinks and everything God feels about us today flows out of his heart of overwhelming, intense, passionate, infinite love. Everything. I once, someone once said, "You, Pastor Dave, I want to know how to be a better dad." And they said, "How can I be a better father?" And I thought about it for a little while, and I asked God for an insight. And God's answer was so ridiculously simple, but it is so profound. If you want to be a better father, try parenting your children the way that God parents you. He doesn't call you names. He doesn't threaten you. He doesn't demean you. He doesn't put you down. He doesn't mock you. He doesn't humiliate you. He doesn't threaten you. If we would just parent our children the way that God parents us, we'd be doing so much better. Because, see, God is a God of love. And so he parents us as a parent of love. And here's the good news about this intense love of God. Intense love will transform us. I have some format problems there. Oh, well. Intense love will transform us. Romans chapter 5, verses 3 to 5. We also rejoice in our sufferings. Oh, that's good news. We rejoice in our sufferings because we know that suffering produces perseverance. Perseverance produces character. Character produces hope. And hope does not disappoint us because God has poured out his love. There it is. He's poured out his love into our hearts by the Holy Spirit, whom he has given us. Okay? He's poured out his love. Now, see, the Apostle Paul, here's a promise. You know, don't you love promises? Here's one you can put on your fridge. Sufferings will come. That's a promise of God. Good news. Sufferings will come. But God promised that suffering would produce perseverance, character, and hope. Well, Pastor Dave, I just happen to know a few people that have suffered. And it didn't result in perseverance, character, hope. It resulted in discouragement, brokenness, and despair. What's with this promise of God that it's going to do that? It's going to produce these positive qualities. Why can God promise this? If you notice, though, there's kind of a... what's the right word? Can't think of the right word. There's a condition if we're going to see suffering produce perseverance, character, and hope. We've got to let God pour out his love into our hearts. Our ability to handle suffering properly requires that we first allow God to pour his love into our hearts by the Holy Spirit. And so the purpose of God's love being poured into us is to empower us so that we will, when we face the junk we face in this world, will actually be transformed into something greater. God says that when you face sufferings with my love, something great will be produced in your life. If you face suffering without my love, without being full of my love, then yeah, you're going to be discouraged. You're going to be full of despair and hopelessness. It's all about God's love. God's love is not given to us to make us feel better. God's love is not given to us to console us. God's love is not given to us to give us warm fuzzies so we just feel better. God's love is given to us to transform us. And if we miss out on that, we've missed out on the primary purpose of the Father's love. It's meant to transform us and make us more like his son Jesus if we allow his love to work in us. I want to talk today about five ways that God's love is expressed. And I hope you catch this, because if you catch this, it is going to really help to transform your life. There are five ways that God's love is expressed so that we can understand and experience his incredible love more and more and more, and let it become a transforming power in our lives, okay? The first way that God's love, or the first expression of God's love, is God's love for God. You say, what? God's love for God? Yeah, God's love for God. See, John 3:35, the Father loves the Son. God the Father loves the Son. God loves God. God the Father loved God the Son. Also, John 14:31. The world must learn that I, Jesus is saying, I love the Father. The Father loves the Son loves the Father. God loves God. Okay? And then we also find out, it's gone. There's a third scripture there. I'm sorry, it's not there. Romans 15:30 says the love of the Spirit. The love of the Spirit is involved too. So the Father is loving the Son and the Spirit. The Son is loving the Father and the Spirit. The Spirit's loving the Father and the Son. God loves God. And the amazing thing is, therefore, this incredible intensity has love called love has existed from eternity past. From all of eternity, love has existed. And love has burned in the Father's heart towards the Son and Spirit, and it was reciprocated, okay? There was this love within the fellowship of the Trinity. From the eternity past, there's this giving and receiving of love back and forth in the Godhead. You'll understand in a couple minutes why that's important. Number two, God's love. The second way God's love is expressed is God's love is expressed towards his people. John 15:9. As the Father has loved me, Jesus says, as the Father's loved me, so I, Jesus, am loving you. Now God is loving us. There's love going on where God's not just loving himself, he's loving us as well. His love has been poured out to us. It's been imparted to us. And so as a result, Jesus loves us with the same intensity that the Father loves Jesus, as the Father has loved me, with the same intensity that he's loved me, Jesus said, I'm loving you. But here's the Father now. I wonder what happened to my formatting. That's weird. Anyway, John 17:23, Jesus prayed, let the world know that you, Father, have loved them, the world, even as you've loved me. So it's not just Jesus, the Son, that loves us with the same intensity he loves the Father. The Father loves us with the same intensity that he loves the Son. Okay? The way that the triune God loves us is the same way that he loves himself. Okay? God doesn't love us just partially. He loves us fully. He loves us intently, or intensely. And his love for us doesn't shrink or grow. Okay? His love for us is infinite in size, and it's eternal in duration. That's his love. Yeah, but I sometimes mess up. Yeah, but he still loves you eternally. Yeah, but I really do some things that I know disappoint. Yes, but he still loves you intensely and eternally. Third expression of God's love. You'll see how this all fits together, hopefully, in a minute. Third expression of God's love is our love back for God. Matthew 22:37-38. Jesus replied, love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, all your mind. Another version that adds, with all your strength. This is the first and greatest commandment. Jesus wants our wholehearted love back to God to be our first priority. Loving God really is the first call of every believer. When you become a believer, God says, I want you to love me. Unfortunately, because Jesus put the word commandment there, we get this strange idea. We tend to see loving God as an obligation. Oh, I've got to love God. It's a commandment. It's like the 11th commandment, right after the Big Ten. Number 11 is, oh, I got to love God. But consider this. God has already poured out his love into our hearts by the Holy Spirit. And so now he's inviting us to love him back with the love that he gave us. He's given us the way to love him back. And that way is by using his love and express it back to him. Why? Because if we love him back using not our own love, but the love he gave us, the love he poured into our hearts, as that supernatural love flows in us and through us back to God, it starts to transform us. So when God invites us and even commands us to love him, it's not because he needs this I just need to be loved by somebody, you know. It's not, it's because he wants his love to flow through us back to him and transform us. So God's command or invitation to love him is God's way of getting his love to transform us. But let's go even deeper. God, the Trinity, catch this please, has been involved in loving himself for all of eternity, right? From all eternity past, God the Father's loving God the Son, the Spirit. God the Son's loving Father and Spirit. God the Spirit loving Father and Son. So God's been involved in loving himself for all of eternity with the full intenseness of his love. By asking us to love God, he's inviting us as human beings to enter into an activity of expressing love that's been going on for all of eternity. He's inviting us to enter into an eternal activity of loving God. He's been loving himself, and he says, come and be part of that. Come and enter into this intense, overwhelming, transformational experience of sharing love in the Godhead by you loving me back. We start to participate with God the Son in loving God the Father and God the Holy Spirit. We start to participate with the Father in loving the Son and the Holy Spirit. We start to participate with the Holy Spirit in loving God the Father and loving God the Son. An eternal experience that God says, I want to invite you to be part of that. Boy, is that transforming or what? When we do that, right? We enter into this incredible experience that the Trinity has been experiencing for all of eternity. Our fourth love, expression of love. Push back. There we go. Our love for ourselves. One of the fourth way that God's love is to be expressed is in loving ourselves. Matthew 22, verse 39. The second part of the command is like it. Love your neighbor as yourself. Love your neighbor as yourself. Well, if we love our neighbor as ourself, then clearly we've got to love ourselves. Right? We've got to love ourselves. In fact, we will never love others more than we love ourselves. So, obviously, this becomes easier when we start to see ourselves the way that God sees us. It becomes easier to love ourselves. But you see, there's a lot more going on here again that we have to get. How do I say this? We've already received God's love, right? He poured out his love into our hearts. And in response, now we've been loving God back with his love and entering into this eternal experience of love in the Godhead. And we've experienced the reality of sharing his love with the Godhead that he's been involved in for all of eternity. And we've experienced this transformation that comes when we start to enter into this eternal experience of sharing God's love with God. And now, as he transforms our love and makes it even deeper, now he says, now you can love yourself. Now that your love is deep, now that your love is pure, now that you've understood the intensity of my love, now no matter what you think about yourself, you can love yourself. Because you're loving yourself with God's love. Well, some people will argue, well, isn't loving ourselves an expression of pride? Isn't it kind of a self-focused or selfish activity? Well, number one, remember that we're not loving ourselves with our love. We're loving ourselves with God's love, okay? And he has already started this whole process by loving us with his love. And so the love that we end up expressing to ourselves is this pure, holy, faultless love. And he says, that's the love I want you to love yourself with. Not this self-centered, proud, arrogant love, but my love. But second, again, this activity of loving yourself has been going on for all of eternity within the Godhead, right? And so when God says, would you start to love yourself, he's saying, I'd like you to be like me. I've been loving myself for all of eternity. I want you to be like me and start loving yourself for the rest of eternity. We are actually demonstrating or copying what God has been doing for all of eternity when we love ourselves. And get this. How do I say this? Because God's love for himself has been going on through all of eternity, it's been going on a lot longer than any expression of God loving his people that's only been going on since all creation. So God's saying, I'm going to invite you from participating in a shorter expression of love, and I'm inviting you into this eternal expression of love. As I have always loved myself in the Trinity, I'm asking you now to start to learn how to do that in your own life for the rest of eternity. There's one. I don't think I quite explained that right. Otherwise, you go, oh. So when we love ourselves, we're being like God. We're being like God, who's always loved himself within the Trinity. He says, just do what I've been doing and let that love transform you. Number five. Yeah. What happened to my format? Our love for others. I'm sorry, the verse isn't there. It's 1 John 4:7. Dear friends, let us love one another, for love comes from God. Let us love one another, for love comes from God. Okay? Love comes from God, so let us love one another. So if we're going to express love, we first have to let God love us and teach us how to love. And the Bible says that love comes from God. And so we first need to experience and receive and experience his love in order to love him back. Love comes from God. So we first need to receive and experience his love in order to love ourselves. Love comes from God. So we first need to receive and experience his love in order to love others. The big mistake we've been making is trying to love others with our poor, immature, imperfect human love. And God said that was never my intention. That's why we have to receive his love first. God has a plan or a priority to let God love us first of all. Okay, that's his priority, love us first. There's the verse. Dear friends, let us love one another, for love comes from God. Love one another, for love comes from God. And as we receive and experience his love, then we're able to love him, love ourselves, and love others. But we have to start. Love one another because love comes from God. So until you get the love from God, you can't love one another the way you want to, no matter how much you try. Okay. God has a but here's the important thing, and I'm a little bit concerned looking at the next slide because I think it's going to be all messed up. But God's love, God has this, get the plan, the flow. I'll try to explain the flow. I'm not sure you're going to be able to see it. Here's the way we've done it wrong. See, we've looked at Luke chapter 10:27. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, all your strength, all your mind, and love your neighbor as yourself. And so we say, oh, okay, I've got to try to love God. To be a Christian, I've got to try to love God. So I'm going to try my best to love him with my fallible, immature, and incomplete love. And then I'm going to try to muster up a little bit extra love, if there's any left, and try to love myself. And then if there's any love left, I'm going to try to love at least a couple other people. Right? Because we're trying to do it with our own strength. But see, most of the time, because we're not loving people and ourselves with God's love, what we express to others is at best conditional love, and at worst it's not even love. It's not love at all. Here's the right way, and the right way. The right way. 1 John 4:19. We love because he first loved us. Okay, get this. We love in response to him first loving us. So part one is receive his love. Receive his love. Receive his love. Oh, there's the picture. Thank you, Lord. There's the picture. What happens? First, here's the plan for God's flow of love. First, Father, Son, the Holy Spirit Father's loving Son, Father's loving Holy Spirit, Son's loving Father and Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit's loving Father and Son. There's this love going on in the triune being. This has existed for all of eternity. And then he says, okay, now in a set point in human history, I'm going to pour out my love on mankind. My love, my love, my love is coming down on mankind. We each one of us get to receive God's love. Then God says, okay, now that you have my love, now you can start to love me back. And we start to love God back, and we, as we do that, we get involved in this eternal experience of love within the Godhead that he has been experiencing for all of eternity. He invites us into that. And now we're being transformed by his love because we're doing what God has been doing for all eternity. We're loving God. And then once we have been transformed by that incredible, intense, eternal love, then we can start to love ourselves with his love. And we love ourselves. And then as we love ourselves, out of the overflow of the love that's matured and grown, out of the overflow, we can start to love others. But the point is, it's got to start up here. We've got to start by receiving his love. If we don't receive love, how on earth can we love ourselves? Because we know ourselves pretty good. And we think we know others, and we don't really like some people. But if we let the Father pour his love into our hearts and then love him back and get caught up in this eternal experience of sharing love, then with this deeper love, we can love ourselves, and there'll be a lot of overflow into other people's lives. Yeah, it's so simple. It's so simple, but we've turned everything into rules and regulations in the kingdom of God. And what happens as we allow this love to work in us and work in us and overflow into other people's lives, we can love with his love. And as a result, we can start boasting. We don't start to say, well, you know, I love God, and we start boasting about our love. No, we start boasting about God's love, not our own, because it's all about God's love. Thank you, Yvette. We start boasting about God's love. And as we boast about God's love, it transforms us more and more, and we fall more and more in love with him. And so our priority, our first priority every day, the thing we need to do more before we do anything else each and every day is just let God love us. That has to become our first priority, because otherwise, where's the love to love him back? Where's the love to love ourselves? Where's the love to love others? Our first priority each day, and you don't have to spend hours, is sit down, like put on the parking brake for 5 minutes in your life. You know, and here's a radical thought. We say, I'm so busy in the morning, I got to rush out the door. How about getting up 5 minutes early then? You know? It's like, some of you guys, I don't know, when we used to start, we meet at 10 o'clock, people were late. They said, well, I just can't get there for 10 in the morning. So we changed it to 10:30. Some people are late. Now it's at 3:30 in the afternoon. Some people are late, right? It's like, get your life together, folks. It's like, so what we do is take some time in the morning, set your clock. I'm trying to do this, so I set my clock half an hour early because I want to make sure I got time to get loved up by God. And you sit there and you don't pray and you don't intercede, right? You just sit there and go, oh God, just love me. I just want to receive your love. And he'll start giving you words of encouragement. He'll start telling you how much he loves you. He'll start telling you these amazing things about you. You think, oh God, that can't be true. You know, and God's loving you. And when he does that, man, is it ever easy? Oh, thank you. God, you're awesome. You're just... Remember the Garden of Eden? There it is. Genesis 3:8. The man, Adam, and his wife, Eve, heard the sound of the Lord God as he was walking in the garden in the cool of the day. God used to come and meet with man, right? God used to come and meet with man in the garden. The point is, to catch this, God came to man first. God didn't say, well, come on up here to heaven, and if you can make it, we're going to have some time together. God came to man. What can we learn from this? Our first priority is not to try to get up to God and love God. Our first priority is to where you are right now, let him come down to you and let him love you. Let him love you. Again, our first priority every day needs to be just let God love you. 10 minutes, 15 minutes, whatever you need, and you'll know. You'll know when you've received God's love. Because then, only then can we love him back with his love. Okay? Do we understand that the primary purpose of prayer is not spiritual warfare, is not intercessory prayer, is not giving God our needs, is not even, in a sense, talking to God? Our highest call in prayer, our first priority in prayer, is simply to put ourselves in a position where we can just let God love us. Let God love us. And let it transform us. Then we can start to love God back. Okay? See, this is how God's love works. My love, God, help me to love. God, help me to love. God, help me to love. God, especially people with pink balloons. God, help me. help me to love. Just kidding. I can have fun too. But see, if we rely on our own love, we're always going to be striving to love. We're always going to be mustering up this imperfect love. But if we do it God's way, God pours out his love on us. We receive his love. Let it transform us. We love him back. We enter into that eternal experience of sharing love within the Godhead. That starts to transform us. Then we have the ability that with his love we can love ourselves. And out of the overflow, not out of the striving, not out of the gritting your teeth, not out of the, oh God, help me, but just out of the overflow, we can love others. That's how love, God's love works, and that's how God's love grows. Do I have my, there it is. 2 Thessalonians 1:3. Paul says, your faith is growing more and more, and the love that every one of you has for each other, it's increasing, and it's increasing, and it's increasing. Why? Because we're learning how to love with God's love and then overflow his love to others. God loves us with the same intensity of love that he loves himself. Even though we're weak and imperfect, God loves us with the same intensity of love that he loves himself. And so the true essence of the Christian life. Yeah, no, let me caveat or pause. If all you ever do is love yourself, there's a problem. James has some things to say, okay? But this has to be your priority. This has to be our priority. Because this is the way that the love of God works. This is the way that this is the essence of the Christian life. Simply learning how to walk in God's love, abide in God's love, receive God's love, stay in God's love. John 15:9. As the Father has loved me, so have I loved you. Then it goes on. So remain in my love. Remain in my love. How do you remain in God's love? That you start in God's love. If you've never received Christ, let the Father pour his love into your heart through the Holy Spirit by making Jesus your King, your sacrifice for sins. And invite the Holy Spirit to take over your life and pour you full of his love. How do you walk in God's love? You start in God's love. But then try starting every day with God's love. I know the days I don't have God's love. You may know the days I don't have God's love for singing in the morning too. It's like, what's wrong with Pastor Dave today? You know, it's that simple. Did I start the day with God's love? Did I take time to receive and experience God's love? If so, eventually it's going to overflow to you guys. If you start each day and make your priority each day receiving God's love, I can promise you, eventually it's going to be poured back out to yourself, to God, and to other people. Okay. So God says, okay, what's your priority as a Christian? Well, to obey the Ten Commandments. And No. What's your priority as a Christian? Remain in my love. Right? Abide in my love. Receive my love each and every day. Enter into this love relationship with me. Let it transform you that you'll be able to love me back. You'll be able to love yourself and you'll be able to love others with my love, God says. And we just live our lives in the overflow of God's love. I'm not trying to say Christianity is just about love, love, love. But the essence of Christianity has to start with a new revelation of the Father's love. Not his blind love that says, boys will be boys, and I'll just cover those messes. That's not what God's talking about. He's talking about, I want to pour my love in your hearts that it will transform you. I'll invite you to enter into this eternal experience of my intense love, sharing in my love, so that you can love me, that you can love yourself, and you can love others. And folks, that just makes everything else come and fall into place. We've got to start with God's love. We've got to start with God's love. Certainly there are other issues, but we're laying foundations. And the foundation can't be, well, you didn't perform well, you dirty, rotten sinner. God's not happy with you, right? The foundation can't be, well, we have a level of perfection here that you better attain to. No. The foundation has to be receiving God's love, letting it transform us, sharing his love back to God, entering into this eternal experience of love in the Godhead, letting that new matured love flow through your own life so that you can love yourself with God's love, and then the overflow is loving others. That's got to be your foundation. Let's stand to our feet. In a couple minutes, I'm going to invite the ministry team up here, and we'll pray for whoever wants the impartation, if you want healing, whatever you need. But folks, let's start. Yeah, let's just take a couple minutes right now and say, Father, Lord, we open our hearts up to you right now. If we've never invited Christ into our life, then we say, Jesus, become my King today. Become my Lord today. I repent of my selfishness, my self-focusedness mentality, and instead I focus on Jesus. I allow him to become my King, and then I invite the Holy Spirit to come and guide me, transform me, and pour out God's powerful love into my life. If we are Christians and we say, God, forgive us for not treating your love with the holy respect it deserves. God, it's like we have a nuclear weapon, a powerful thing from God in his love, and we treated it like a warm, fuzzy emotion. Father, today we just say, Lord, come with your love. Lord, come with your love today. Come with your love. Fill us afresh today. Yes, Lord. We receive your love right now. Even though it's afternoon already, we receive your love right now. We receive your love. We ask you to fill us with your love. Lord, we want to experience your love. So folks, just take a moment. If you got to raise your hands, if you got to put your hands like a cup, whatever it takes to receive from God right now. Lord, come, we receive. We receive. We receive. We invite the transforming love of the Creator to come into our hearts and lives today. Fill us, oh God. Lord, we will, yes, love you back. We will love ourselves. We will love others. But Lord, for right now, we just got to get filled with your love. So we don't want to sound selfish, but God, we want to sound desperate. We want to sound desperate for you. We desperately need your love today. Fill us, oh God, with your love. Fill us, oh God, with your love. Your transforming love. Your tender-hearted love. Your powerful love. Your eternal love. Now let him speak to you. Let him love on you. Let him love on you. Let him tell you words of affection, words of love. My beloved son, my beloved daughter. Oh, how precious you are to me. How I find joy in you. How you excite me by your passion, your desire towards me. Oh, there's great things in store for you. I've created you from within your mother's womb for a plan and a purpose. I haven't given up on you. I have not given up on you. I'm not ashamed of you. There is yet good things in store for you. Just receive my love. Just receive my love. Be filled. I've seen your works. I know your weaknesses, but I will never turn my back on you. I will never be ashamed of you. My heart is intense. My love is intense towards you. It will never wane. It will never shrink. My love for you today is exactly the same as it was on the day that Jesus died for you. Come and experience the fullness of my love. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Father, for your love. Thank you, Father, for your love. Lord, I pray that each and every day, as we make it a priority, the priority, to first be filled with your love. Lord, I pray that each one of us would start to come with testimonies of today the love of God was poured out afresh. Not just dripped, not just sprinkled, but the love of God was poured out afresh into my life today. And because of that, everything changed. Everything changed. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for your love. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for your love. Thank you, Father, for your love. And thank you for the wonderful invitation of loving you back with the love you first gave us. And as we do that, we get involved in this eternal experience of sharing love in the Godhead. Lord, let it transform us. Let it transform. In Jesus' name, all God's people said, amen.